Radio V. Radio in TV.
Radio in TV.
Hey, we're back, episode 2, on the green carpet at T Radio V. I'm really, really excited about the shows with Stephen Powers, producer extraordinaire, entrepreneur, and Mark Johnson, founder of Playing for Change. Thanks, guys, for coming out.
Our joy. Thank you.
So, Stephen, you know, I've met you about 15 years ago, and you were running Drive Entertainment. What was Drive Entertainment?
Drive Entertainment was one of a series of record labels, media entertainment companies that I founded. This one started in the early 90s with my partner Don Grierson, also a notable A&R producer fellow, who I originally met at Capitol Records. And we did a number of different types of music. I mean, it was an eclectic concept, as most of my companies have been. This one in particular, we did a big series of reissues of jazz, blues, swing, big band music.
I know, because I saw the photo of you with Les Brown. So how did that ever, what was that relationship with you and Les Brown Jr., I should say?
Well, as I said, we had a series called the Drive Archive. We also produced new music at Drive, but we had a series of reissues, the Drive Archive, and Les has a big library. For many years, the Les Brown Orchestra played at the Palladium, and they recorded everything. So these were really excellent recordings from the 40s and 50s at the peak of the big band era when the Les Brown Orchestra was at its peak. And so I can't remember how I met Les exactly, but we connected, and I licensed about 10 albums from him, including a Les Brown album, but other things done at the Palladium. And then that friendship and that relationship grew into the decision to make a PBS special based on swing music. This was 1996. It was the peak of the swing revival. So we went to PBS, and we pitched this idea of Les being kind of the cornerstone of a big band show that showed the evolution of swing music from the 1930s through now 1996. So the Brian Setzer Orchestra kind of capped off the evening. That was the year they had their hit of Jump, Jive, and Wail.
Oh, that's so funny, because I remember being at Les Brown Jr.'s house and him showing me the video and him telling me about, like, he was going to do a PBS special. But he never told me that you were the producer of that. That's so funny.
We were the co-producers. Les and I together were the co-producers
of
the special.
He's been an old friend, you know, helped me on my first film on Catalina Island. So that's interesting. And I saw a bunch of photos, you with John Lee Hooker, and you were on the Conan. What was the shot with you and Conan? I was trying to figure that out. Where did that come from?
Well, his band, of course, on the Late Night with Conan O'Brien was the Max Weinberg Seven.
Okay.
So I produced an album with Conan, with Max Weinberg.
You mean the drummer of Bruce Springsteen?
The drummer of Bruce Springsteen, and of course the big band leader.
I'm a huge Bruce Springsteen fan, just so you know.
Yeah. I got to meet Bruce Springsteen, not through Max, but through his producer of many years, Chuck Plotkin, who was a partner of mine in another company that I founded called Chameleon Music Group. I literally had dinner with Bruce and his wife, what's her name, the singer is in his band.
Isn't that fascinating how
they're
that
still
happened?
Married.
You and had dinner with the boss?
I had dinner with the boss, yeah. It was really a moment for me.
People always ask me that question. You know, it's really interesting. We talk about, like, you know, celebrities and musicians, and I'm not like a starstruck type person, but it's just so interesting when you meet these people, how they're just regular people, right? Like, totally down
absolutely.
Earth.
We had a dinner conversation and, you know, chatted about all kinds of things.
Cares probably about the same things, politics, what's going on in the environment.
Music. I remember we talked a lot about some of the musical groups. We brought him to see one of the bands that was on Chameleon called Mary's Danish, which some people may remember, a great alternative rock band. And he had come out to see them because Chuck wanted him to see them. So
what was it like with Max Weinberg, the drummer?
Well, Max is a great professional.
He's one of the best drummers, right?
Well, amazing drummer, yeah. Absolutely. And he's a very precise, as drummers are, you know, if they're going to be great, they are, right? So in all aspects of his personality and in his life, he's very precise. So I really enjoyed working with him because he knew what he wanted. He articulated it very well. The album itself is a swing, kind of a jump music
record. Oh, really? I didn't know that.
Record. Yeah, that's what it is.
So it's interesting. So here you have a traditional music background. You know, you're a record producer. You've got a label. When did you make the switch into transformational, you know, entertainment? What was the light bulb? What happened?
Well, I began by attending the Agape International Spiritual Center some 20-plus years ago.
So who was the person responsible for bringing you, down there?
It was music. It was my neighbor across the street who said to me, "Hey, Stephen, I go to this place." It was in the early days of Agape, back on Olympic. And he said, "And the music is great."
No, I've been down there. I went down there once. I had a friend of mine, Jan Reese, who was a producer. And she's like, "You got to have an Agape experience." And here I am, a Jewish guy, and I'm like, "Agape?" I'm like, I didn't know what you're talking about. I thought it was Greek. And we went down there, and I was totally moved. It was non-religious. It was completely spiritual. I met people that people were hugging. It was just really, it was a very profound experience.
Exactly. And so, as you say, it's trans-denominational. We're just as interested in the wisdom of Jesus as Buddha, as Krishna, Muhammad, you know, so all the great
That's
avatars
interesting.
Trans-denominational.
Of time. Mm-hmm. I never heard that word before.
It's a way, I think, of describing this kind of potpourri of wisdom or smorgasbord of wisdom that you might want to choose from all the great, you know, ancient wisdom that exists. So I was attending Agape for many years, and then another music business friend of mine, Kit Thomas, New Age producer, told Michael Beckwith and Ricky Byers Beckwith, "Hey, there's this guy who comes to Agape, you know, he's pretty accomplished in the music business, we might want to enroll him," which is kind of their way, you know, how do we get you to volunteer and do stuff for us? So they invited me into the music ministry, and then eventually Michael approached me and said, "I'd like you to co-found Agape Media. Ricky and I have this vision of creating a media company."
You know, it's interesting because when you sent me all your media and I was going through everything and figuring out the show guide, there was the clip that I saw of, was it like the Light Bites, I think it's called?
Life Bites.
Life Bites. And as I was listening to this, and hopefully they're going to play it on the commercial break, I was like, wow, this is like, you were able to say it in such an elegant way. Because when people, most people say a thing about transformation or damn it, they get lost and confused. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? It's kind of like when people think about the green carpet, like, well, what is the green carpet? It's like how do you take cause and storytelling and make a difference in the world? And that is a transformational experience. And that's what you're up to, it sounds
like.
Yeah,
well, thank you for that compliment. I think that's one of the issues with transformational entertainment is that people have not been able to describe it in a way that doesn't sound confusing. So, it's like, what's that about? So I've been working on that. Of course, that's a part of what marketing is all about, is how can you identify something in the fewest amount of words in the most common language that people understand. So perhaps my ability to describe it came from struggling with it for years.
Well, I thought it was really interesting too, because, you know, as I was sifting through your content, what I realize is that's what an experience is in terms of cinema. Mm-hmm. Like, we go on a journey, right, for, you know, an hour, 90 minutes, 2 hours, or a concert, right, and we have an epiphany. You know what I mean? Something happens. Mm-hmm. But we don't package it like, oh, it's called transformation entertainment, right? I mean, I was kind of thinking about Jaws and Steven Spielberg's and Jaws. Like, that's an experience. You might not go in the ocean.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, once you're done with it, right? Exactly.
We were just watching that show at my wife Britta the other night. We were thinking about that. And there's the other thing, just talking about that. Like, last night or 2 nights ago, we were out at the Kodak Theater, at the Dolby Theater, and we were listening to Neil Young perform live. And, you know, his first 4 songs, they were all love songs. Mm-hmm. And here you think of this guy.
Cinnamon Girl, sure.
You know, Crazy Horse, you know, mm-hmm. Wild Guy. And here these first 4 songs are just all about love. And he's like, hello, this is what it's all about. So I just thought it was very interesting, the power of music, which sort of leads me into Mark. You know, how did you get involved in the music industry?
Well, I was at the University of New Hampshire. I was studying interpersonal communication, and I needed a job. It said a live sound engineer needed with no experience necessary, and I was the only one that went to the interview. So
you got the job by default?
So I got the job, and I've been involved with music ever since.
And what was so give me a little bit of your background, Mark. So you went to New Hampshire, and
I went to New Hampshire, and so I was recording music as the sound engineer for the school, and then I needed a job afterwards. A diploma in interpersonal communication wasn't knocking down doors for me, so I had applied for a job at a famous recording studio in New York City called the Hit Factory.
Oh yes.
Oh yeah. And where is the Hit Factory located?
It was located in Midtown Manhattan, two different facilities.
So when we say Midtown Manhattan, I'm originally from New York.
So 54th and Broadway.
Because I always think of Midtown as like 34th and like Madison. Like, you know what I mean? But some people think I'm more like Uptown, right?
Okay, Uptown.
More Uptown, right?
Yeah. So so I got a job.
By the way,
there.
There's a lot of controversy. What I just said, like, where is Midtown?
Yeah, they're tuning out in New York, right?
Oh, yeah.
No, that's not right.
Yeah, so I got a job at a recording studio and at the Hit Factory, and I would.
We're going. I think we're about. Funny enough, we're gonna come back to that. I can't believe it. It's already been like our first 10. Can you believe it? That's how fast things move? So we're about to cut to commercial, but we're gonna come back and hear Mark your backstory about Playing for Change and what you're doing.
Great.
Great. Thanks, guys.
Joining us. This is Life Bites Live. I'm Nina Bosky, and with me in studio is Stephen Powers. He is the president of Agape Media International, and I'm so excited to have you here with us talking about a lot of things. So welcome to the show.
Thank you, Nina.
So when we talk about transformational media or entertainment, a lot of people still don't know quite what that is. What do you mean by that?
Well, it's a nuanced answer. People are aware of what faith-based media is and maybe what inspirational media is, but the difference is that in transformational media, you're actually seeking to give people tools to change their life, not just to give them an energy to change their life, but literally to bring about that change. And it also is, I think, much broader. In other words, we're not just speaking to spiritual or religious themes, and Agape itself is not religious. It is spiritual, and again, that's a...
Hi, I'm Moby, and you're watching T-Radio V.
We call it Dark Matter with Dave Navarro.
It's not like Amanda Joe, or it's just Joe?
Oh, it's just Joe with a dash after it.
Really? That's very, very strange. Oh. Joe Dash?
Are you the facts of life, Joe?
Are you the spawn of Down syndrome parents? J-O dash?
I think that we should all, for the rest of the show, add a dash to the ends of our names so she
Dave
doesn't
dash.
Feel bad. Dan Dash,
yes.
Jess Dash, Todd Dash, Dave Dash, Joe Dash.
It's Dark Matter with Dave Navarro, Wednesdays at 9 p.m. on T-Radio V.
T-Radio V.
What did you play opposite Andy, Eric? Do you remember?
Andy and I worked as two employees at a network.
Okay. Oh, you're forgetting the other thing.
I played a news anchor, and he played a reporter.
Okay, but the other thing you did, the thing you did on the Andy Dick show, who did you play to Andy?
Oh, is that going to play my sister?
You played his wife, Denise.
Yeah.
Yeah, you played his wife.
Yeah.
So what's wrong with that, Eliza?
Yeah. Nothing's wrong with it.
He's got a great range as an actor.
Yeah, it just was funny.
Encounters with Eric and Eliza Roberts, Wednesdays from 2 to 4 p.m. on T-Radio V.
T-Radio V. Radio in TV.
Radio in TV.
So we're back here at On the Green Carpet with Stephen Powers and Mark Johnson. So Mark, you were telling me about your backstory. So you, by default, you got a job.
By default, I got a job at the University of New Hampshire. That led me on the music path. I then got a job at the Hit Factory in New York City, essentially getting food for hip-hop artists.
Oh,
I would
really?
Run around New York City and get them.
So who were some of the hip-hop artists you were working with?
Right, well, eventually I got to record albums for them as well. So I recorded with Biggie Smalls back in the day.
Okay.
And a young Jay-Z and Nas. And
what was Jay-Z like?
He was great. Yeah, he was really nice. I mean,
I've always wondered about, like, when I see Jay-Z and, like, his personality. I'm like, here's a guy, he's got all the money in the world, right? He's got a beautiful wife. What was he like?
To be honest, the days that I worked with him, he was great. And I remember him bringing in, like, his nephews. They had all had little suits
on. So he was family-oriented,
yeah, he brought
words.
Them in to enjoy it.
When you say great, that's such of like a it's like a noun. It's very small. Like,
yeah, right. Yeah. But he was a great person to me that day. And
so he was friendly. He interacted with you. He didn't treat you like an intern
no.
if you were getting the food or anything like that.
No, he was great.
That's one of the things I think needs to be said about a lot of the stars that I've known and worked with is that they have a great generosity of spirit. They are realized in in their lives. So they're able to be giving. They're able to be. There's not all these stories of the, you know, the.
Yeah.
The
really well, you
nasty
hear
stars.
The stories.
Yeah,
you know
those
I mean?
Are the
that's,
ones you hear.
I think that's the. That's why I want. You asked me, like, you know, before we started the show, like, what I want to do on the green carpet, because I felt there was an appetite for this type of entertainment where people could actually realize that there are a lot of really great people that are actually changing the world that actually want to be part of the green carpet. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
Not everything's all red and, you know, sizzle.
Me, me,
and,
me.
Yeah, me, 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 with your glamour and your lipstick and, you know, your high heels and your, you know, it's not, that's not really the world we live in. That's sort of like, it's sort of like a back page. You know,
from my history, the person who comes up is Tina Turner, who,
oh, I
you
love
know,
Tina
at the
Turner.
Peak of her stardom, oh. You know, was so kind, so generous, so open, had been practicing Buddhism and meditation
really?
for 20 years in her sort of recovery from the Ike and Tina days.
Didn't she also date someone from like Pink Floyd, like one of the, or marry someone like the engineer, I think? I think I read that, by the way, like someone from Europe, like one of the producers. Yeah.
I don't know. That
I had
story.
No idea about that either. I thought that was fascinating.
I just know that she was a kind person when I met her.
Wow.
Know?
Buddhist. What do you think a Buddhist is?
What do I think it is?
Yeah.
Well, it's clearly a several thousand year old wisdom tradition that is about introspection and inner awareness and really beginning and ending when you look to grow and develop with yourself.
You know, it's
so don't look outside of yourself, look within.
Look within. I always think, like, what is the Buddha? You know, yeah. Bring the Buddha within all of us. So, okay, so Mark.
Well, I'm laughing only because one of the sessions I also worked on was Wu-Tang Clan with Bjork after she had just come from visiting
oh,
the
wow.
Dalai Lama.
Wow. Oh, nice.
And
Bjork.
I don't think you could have
there's
two different worlds
come together.
Wu-Tang Clan coming with Bjork after she'd visited with the Dalai Lama, so that was an amazing.
So let's just speed track.
So yeah, I'll speed track.
So you were.
So basically,
so after you went,
I'm recording
from,
all these kinds of music, and
yeah.
I ended up recording hip hop, and then I recorded for Paul Simon for a year,
love
and
Paul
become
Simon.
An engineer for Paul, and so on. And I'm on my way to work in a subway station, and there are these two monks painted all in white, with robes on. One of them playing a guitar, and the other one was singing, and I don't know in what language. I imagine most people didn't. But on this day, I come down into the subway platform, and it's packed, and nobody's getting on the train. And I think maybe something's wrong. But I'm following this music, and all of a sudden, I did have this epiphany, because I look around, and I see, like, a homeless man next to a businessman, and a little kid next to an elderly person, and everybody watching this music, and everybody making it their own. Mm-hmm. Some people crying and smiling, and, you know, just took in this moment. And then I get on the train and I start to go to work and I say, man, I think the best music I ever heard is on the way to the studio and not in the studio.
Mm.
So I said, what am I going to spend my life in there? But what I just got inspired by was on the way to it. So I decided, all right, I'm going to build a mobile recording studio, same equipment I use with Paul Simon, power it with golf cart batteries. And I'm going to travel all over subways and Indian reservations and street corners and find music like that. Things that can inspire us as true connections as human beings, you know? So I decided on the way to the studio.
By the way, I totally resonated with what you just said. I remember my days. I worked in book publishing. When my first job, I worked at Oxford University Press. I used to take the subway every morning. Going through that subway station, I'd always hear the guys playing, and be like, they were just amazing artists. And I always felt so bad for them. I was like, God, I was like, where is their voice? Is there ever a platform for them? And I've always felt like they were like the heroes, you know what I mean? Like
yeah.
The artists. And it's interesting that you built a business pretty much around that.
Yeah, I mean, you know.
A worldwide phenomenon.
A worldwide phenomenon, I would actually say, yeah. Because you think about it, like I go online, I see, so for me, I met Evan Mattison, who is the founder of the International Day of Peace, and I'm going on Facebook, and all of a sudden I see, and I've heard Playing for Change, it came up like about four or five times, then you mentioned it to me at a mm-hmm. screening, and I'm seeing, you know, the people there, and I'm like, this is really interesting. And by the way, great marketing, what you've done with the colors. Really, 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 I was impressed.
Thank you.
Yeah. So go on, I didn't mean to cut you off.
No. So that really led to what was the birth of Playing for Change. It was in that subway that day of just realizing great music and art, their moments in time.
Do you remember the train?
No, I don't remember the train.
Was it
the Union
train?
Square?
Where were you?
It was
in Union Square?
Union Square, yeah.
You gotta get them to do that song, right? Get on that right train.
And then the monks, what were they playing?
They were playing their own music. You
what
know?
Kind of music, though?
It was acoustic, a
really?
Voice and a nylon guitar. But it was such a beautiful thing, and that led me into saying, okay, I want to go find these moments in time and record them and film them, and then because I make records, I wanted to string them together, so add different musicians around the, you know, different locations onto the same song.
So how do you now go about, I mean, recruiting, I guess, or sourcing, you know, I mean, I was looking at some of the photos I mean, I fell in love with the photos. I was like, you know, you see these people. I mean, it's like going to Jamaica. It's like you feel like you're like on the estate or on the farm. It was really, really cool. Like, how do you go and source your music?
Well, like Stephen and I were saying, I mean, I think a lot of it is just showing up. You know, there's no shortage of great music all over the world.
Yeah, but like, how do you get to Nigeria or like in the Congo or like, you know what I mean? Like, I mean, you are physically here. Do you go to those places?
Yeah, I mean, I've traveled over 45 countries with a mobile recording studio, cameras. And recorded and filmed. That's the way, you know, you got to
say that
show
again.
Up.
Hold on. You have recorded
pictures of these.
Yeah, right? I know. That's it. We're live. We're cutting. But we're okay. Yeah. So you said 45
countries I've traveled recording and filming music.
Wow.
And each one of those, you show up, you meet people, you learn how they make sense of the world. You see, all back to my interpersonal communication major. How do other people make sense of the world, and how can we use that as a way, a context to connect?
And what do you think the artists, like when you meet them and you tell them about your brand, Playing for Change, what's going on with them? I mean, what's that kind of conversation?
One of the first musicians I met in Los Angeles, I used to record albums for Jackson Browne, and I was going to his studio, and I heard a street performer on the 3rd Street Promenade, and I walked down there, and I heard this guy singing Stand By Me, and I just remember him sounding like Otis Redding, and I remember saying to him, in a set break, I said, hey, if I come back with some recording equipment and cameras, I want to record you and film you playing Stand By Me. I'm going to travel the world, put headphones on musicians, and add them to the song. He looked at me like I was crazy. But he said, hey, if you come back, I'll play the song. When I came back, I said, man, with a voice like yours, why are you singing on the street? And he said, because I'm in the joy business. I come out to bring joy to the people. I mean, this guy is one of the best singers in the history of singers. And so,
unequivocally,
there's no reason for him to have to, you know, this is where he gets his joy. There's no division between him and his audience. You know, you were saying you feel sorry for them. I feel sorry for famous musicians.
Well, I don't feel sorry
to change what they do in order to be heard.
I don't feel sorry for them. Let me reiterate that. I mean, it's more a matter of, understanding, like they're artists and they want their voice heard. And so there's more of like an epiphany. Like, I don't feel bad for them because they do it because they love the deal.
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
They found, like, honestly, those guys that are out there and they're performing down at the subway station, they enjoy what they do.
Yeah.
They're having a blast.
Right.
But what I was really getting at was, I'm sure or maybe not. Maybe they actually just enjoy that platform. And for them, but some of them might want to be on a, you know, they want their CDs. But also, there's also, they still have their tip jars. There's still the commerce part. You know what I mean? There's that financial reality of being an artist and a musician and, you know.
That's the connection you're suggesting, is that there's a direct connection between the amount of money that you get and joy. And what Mark is understanding, what the musicians are saying is, no,
yeah,
it's
because
the joy.
That's the paradox of the whole thing.
Do you think he's a producer? That was such a producing moment, right?
Yeah.
Getting lost in the confusion. You come in, it's like, no, let's just get to it, right?
Yeah. A lot of the places I've been, the worst places in the world, the best musicians, the poorest places, the happiest people. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, it's just you got to look at the world for what it really is, not this lens we've been
taught. So what about, like, Iceland? Have you ever gone to Iceland?
No, but we're touring there this
year.
There
you go.
Because I'm always curious, like, you know, like the nomadic places where it's really cold, you know, are they playing? You know?
I've just gone to the places where it's really hot.
Okay. Well, yeah, I was going to say, like, have you gone to, like, Scandinavia, like Sweden, Norway?
This year we're actually touring the Playing for Change band all through those countries.
I guarantee you they're playing music in Iceland, you know.
Oh,
although,
sure.
You know, maybe with gloves on.
That's where Björk was from, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. So that's just fascinating. And so how are you packaging all this stuff? Are you making a CD or
they're all released as CD DVD packages called Songs Around the World.
Are they single CDs or are they packaged?
They're
like
packaged
a
CD and a DVD together.
Okay.
This is our third one that comes out June 17th at Starbucks.
Wow.
Releasing the CD DVD. And
The DVD in Starbucks.
Yeah.
I've never seen that before.
Right. But, I mean, you have to see these, you know. I mean, you want to put the CD so you can drive in your car.
Oh, I see. So it's packaged as a CD, but there's a DVD inside the CD.
It's the fact that you realize that these are street musicians, that this is live. That's what
makes
it so fascinating.
And on this new record, you know, we've transformed from street musicians. There are a lot of street musicians. There's also Aztec Indians
and
Keith Richards.
All right.
Yeah, and I was thinking about that. Like,
it goes all the way across.
You made him get on the street to record.
Yeah, we recorded Keith in the Caribbean.
When I saw that, I was like, I saw Jackson Browne. I've met Jackson Browne, cool guy, great musician. But when I saw Keith Richards, I kept thinking to myself, where did he, like,
Right. Because it's all about music. Yeah. And that's what everybody who's involved with music, for the right reasons, they remember that. I mean, music is for everybody.
But did he find you? Or did you
find
Keith
him? He contacted us through his team because of we've done a version of Give Me Shelter around the world.
You know, by the way, we're playing that song.
He has a great awareness of where music is coming from. He wanted to record with John Lee Hooker and did as well.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Because he just knows his roots.
I'm loving this conversation. We're going to come back on the green carpet with Stephen Powers and Mark Johnson. Thanks, guys.
If I don't get some shelter, oh yes, I'm going to fade away.
My name is Roger Ridley, and I'm in the joy business. Seus passos perdidos e que os sonhos despertem esses olhos dormidos, que o amor transborde e vivamos em paz. Que os dias terminem com os braços cansados e que a sorte só queira estar ao teu lado, que a dor não me assombre nem me cause desvelo.
Hi, this is Slim Jim Phantom, and you got the big beat. We're gonna take this music into the 22nd century. We deal exclusively in rockabilly music. Elvis Presley, Jerry Lee Lewis, Carl Perkins, Chuck Berry, Little Richard, Richie Valens, Wanda Jackson, Janis Martin, the Everly Brothers, Johnny Cash, and everybody else. Thank you so much for supporting the big beat here on T Radio V.
Andy D on T Radio V.
Bing bang bing boom, right?
Yeah.
Andy D on T Radio V. Bobbity bibbity bobbity boo. Andy D on T Radio V.
The Andy Dick Show, Wednesdays from 4 to 6 p.m. on T Radio V.
Wow!
So but Paul, we'll do it better when the show actually starts.
Yeah, no.
T Radio V. Radio in TV.
Radio in TV.
Cool, super cool. Well, we're back here live on the green carpet with Stephen Powers and Mark Johnson. So we were just talking about, like, you know, can you actually make money doing good in the world? You know, can you actually, is it a sustainable enterprise? You know, I feel like you guys are like the pioneers. So Stephen, you know, like when you were at Agape Media, like, was it sustainable?
Well, it went on for 7 years, so okay. I guess is that sustainable by definition? I guess
yes.
In a sense.
Well, I mean, you could be there for 7 years, but I mean, were you a salary employee?
We were a bootstrapped enterprise. Okay. We never had a big pool of venture capital to spend. It just came out of the enterprise itself and generated it. So I think the answer is yes. We had moments of ebb and flow where that happened. Some of our bigger enterprises were funded by people who saw, you know, what is called cause marketing, right? So they want to identify their products or their services with something that they know is good. So for example, the PBS special with Michael Bernard Beckwith was sponsored by a wonderful green food, superfoods company called the Synergy Company.
Okay.
They had been in business for 25 years, one of the largest producers of a green superfood called Pure Synergy and many other wonderful stuff. A gentleman named Mitchell May, right? Now, Mitchell's been doing good work.
Are you giving him a product endorsement right now?
Sure, because well, he gave us.
I got an ad guy who probably want that. Let's just so Mitchell, you know, Josh, right, we've got like a major superfoods company. That's actually really cool,
but
by
so
the
there's
way.
An example. It's like, who can benefit from association with the good work that you're doing? How do they benefit, right? And he wanted his brand, his foods, which are good inherently.
Yes.
I mean,
I'm
to
a
be,
huge. By the way, I have a rooted smoothie every morning where I actually have soup. I actually
use Pure Synergy, one of the best.
No, it's I don't really use good. It. I actually get it directly from South America. I actually get the acai.
Oh, yeah. Excellent.
And I get chia seeds and all these things from Navitas Naturals. They actually ship them to me in bags, and I actually make a protein shake every morning.
So one of the models that
really
works.
So I'm a huge fan of superfoods, just, you know,
yeah,
it works.
One of the models that works when you're doing good work like Mark's doing with Playing for Change is who that is making money is a commercial business would benefit by association cause marketing, right? So
yeah.
That's one of the things that works. And then there's also the fact that some great products and great productions over the years that are inherently good have been tremendously successful. It isn't just the horror films and the bad stuff.
So speaking about films, you have a new TV show. I was watching the trailer.
I
do. Tell me
about it. And that's all about being good, too. It's called Soul Search.
And you have Sister Jenna,
who I know.
Who's a very interesting lady.
The head of the Brahma Kumaris,
yes.
Which is a wonderful spiritual tradition.
Huge. Tell me a little bit about the Brahma Kumari.
Founded about 90 years ago in India, sort of what I call the New Thought Hinduism, you know, the awareness of the Baba who you know, said, hey, Hinduism is great, but there's God is energy, God is light, God is source. It's not these thousand Ganesh and Shiva and all the images that we love and celebrate, but that's not really what it's about. So he founded this, a Brahmin being the upper caste of India. A Kumari means to be of service. So he realized that a Brahmin being of service, it has become a worldwide organization, again, transdenominational, spiritual, not religious, so not a lot of dogma associated with it, just be good, be yourself. It's in 120 countries. There's more than 8,000 centers.
I know there's a lot of centers.
Here in the United
States. I thought there were 10,000.
They're in
every 8,000.
8,000,
yeah,
every major
huge.
City in the United States. And Sister Jenna sort of heads up the U.S. operations here out of Washington, D.C., where she is a... like an ambassador, like a spiritual ambassador.
She
goes
ambassador.
To the White House.
Yes.
You know, she goes to the United Nations, and she brings her essential beingness of peace, love, and awareness, you know, into these environments.
And who's
great.
The other character? You have another female.
Yeah, Kelly Sullivan Walden is a dream expert. She's a best-selling author.
So hold on. Slow down for a second. Fascinating. Dream expert.
Yes.
We're just talking about that with a friend of mine. I was trying to get on the show about, like...
The basic idea is this. Just as we're aware that meditation can access your subconscious, right? Your awareness beyond your awareness, so do our dreams. They are a portal to your subconscious. They're a portal to your supermind. And so if you really become aware of how dreams are, archetypes in dreams, and how they're representative of what you're either thinking about consciously or unconsciously,
mm-hmm.
you can access information. And some of the great creations of all time by artists have occurred in the sleep.
Oh, absolutely.
Right? And they woke up and I had an awareness and I dreamed this song, right?
So tell me, like, so where is this show going to be? How do I find it? I know we're going to show the trailer. I saw the trailer. I love the trailer. Yeah, I'm a little biased. But I met Sister Jenna. I've interviewed her for my film.
Well, the premise of the show is that we're going out to see unusual spiritual practices. So we just came from Miami, for example, where we visited the Umbanda people.
Okay.
And Umbanda, you may know about from Brazil, was an African tribalism spirituality that blended with Catholicism because they didn't allow the black people who were the slaves in Brazil 200 years ago to practice their African tribalism. So they hid it within Catholicism, which was the accepted practice of the time, and it ended up being 200 years later a blended religion. So that's
really an episode.
What it is. And you find that throughout the Caribbean, the Santeria, the Kimbanda, you know, there's all these religions that are a blend of African tribalism because of the diaspora of the blacks.
So
it's on, to answer your question,
I was trying to get to
Brahma Kumari TV, which
okay.
is carried in every country. It's on the Dish Network here in the United States.
Wow.
But we're also pitching it, actually. We're going to take it to OWN. So, we're going to take it to PBS.
Dish is like 40 million, right?
Yeah. So that's a start. But
well, that's huge.
Could be bigger.
Stop. Okay. Dish Network, 40 million. That's a major distribution.
I mean,
don't take away.
So this is fun for me because it's putting me in a different role instead of in front behind the camera.
I know you're on
producer.
Camera. I saw you. I was like, there he is. And what's your challenge? Like what's your part in the show?
Well, I'm one of the seekers. So there are the three of us: Sister Jenna, Kelly Sullivan Walden, and I are the three seekers and guides. So
okay.
we're supposed to know maybe a little something more than the average person, but I don't know if we really do.
Oh, you definitely do.
And we go out and we... And
I don't know about you, but I feel like I'm getting a world-class education on this show right now. I mean, you are definitely have graduated from Agape International. And stamp. You know, we have, just so you know, my buddy was on the show, created this concept called the cool factor, where it's 100% cool. And I'm giving you the 100% cool, because you are 100% cool in knowing...
So the challenge for for me is to take off my producer hat. You know,
okay.
I literally sit there and I want to be present to the conversation, to each other, to the awareness, and not be going, that camera ought to be over here, or that audio mic isn't here. So I'm learning to not be the producer and rather be the talent. So that's the challenge aspect of it.
That's a huge challenge.
But the joy of it is, for me, is being that.
Yeah.
So I get to, literally, when you take a break, you know this, Mark, or you even as a producer, you know, when you're the producer, you're never stopping, right? During every break, you're setting up the next stuff and so forth. I get to go sit with the other people and have some coffee or tea or, you know, take a break and not worry about what's next in the shoot. So I'm
so who's
producing
the show?
It's called House of International Media.
I saw
They're an Indian-based company. They
okay.
produce Brahma Kumari TV, which has like 10 million viewers itself.
Okay.
And the three Indian guys, three brothers, amazing. They're part of the Brahma Kumari tradition, which means they're a renunciate. So they are, you know, they're celibate. They don't have any money.
No,
they just do good work.
Yeah, I know the Brahmanians are celibate. I was told they take a
vow of poverty,
a vow of
service. So their whole life is dedicated to service. So you get these three young brothers with great chops, great skills. By the way, they just have a new movie that's released. I should plug it. It's called The Time Is Now.
Okay.
It's actually in theaters in like 10 cities in the United States.
Fabulous.
Opened last weekend.
And who's distributing that? Is that House of International as
no,
well?
No. It's a company out of New York. A theatrical film distribution
okay.
company picked it up.
Oh, wow.
It's a film about violence
maybe we
and
can
about
put
solutions
maybe
to violence.
Maybe we can put them on the show.
You should have them. They're coming out here.
I would love
They're
to have
great.
Them. Yeah, we'll get them on the show. That's great. That's one of the things.
Prabhu, Prashant, and Vishal.
I love it.
The three Indian
I
brothers.
I think she was telling me about that, Sister Jenna, about
yeah.
about that film and what they were doing when I was interviewing her.
They're so dedicated and talented.
So I just want to flip the chip. By the way, unbelievable.
Yeah, amazing.
Amazing. Well, I think what you give is you give a sense of hope for all the filmmakers that actually don't have to make a horror film. They don't have to go, you know, make a slasher. You know
mm-hmm.
what I mean? They can actually make entertainment that actually has a channel. And when I say the Dish Network, Dish is huge. But I just wanted to flip the channel because you mentioned like in getting into Starbucks. And Starbucks, as we
That's
know.
That's a great channel.
Well,
yeah.
First of all, like, I've had a couple of interactions with Starbucks. One of my friends who was, I won't mention her, but anyway.
You bought a latte and a whip.
Yeah, you know, but, you know, getting to Starbucks is a major coup. Like, you know, like, here you are playing for change. Starbucks is a commercial enterprise. Talk to me, like, you know, like,
yeah.
why you? I mean, they have their own record label. They're putting out their own music. Whoa.
Right. You know, I had made a film of traveling around the world with that Stand By Me video.
Okay.
Called Peace Through Music. The
awesome.
Film was on,
seen it,
was on a Tribeca Film Festival.
Okay.
And from there, we got the film in the hands of Norman Lear.
Oh, yeah.
And Norman is one of my greatest friends in the world and since that day. And Norman shepherded, you know, he shepherded it to Howard Schultz, the founder of Starbucks, as
go.
Well as many other people around the world. And, you know, really just is the living, breathing example of making the world a better place.
Isn't
you
know, he's
agreed,
extraordinary.
You know?
They have a thing, what was it, the Emma, right, that he's part of with Rob Reiner. He's one of the founders of the Environmental Media Association.
Yeah, exactly.
Norman Lear, of course, the king of television.
King
all
of television.
In the family,
yeah, all in the family.
Years, but has done such much great work since.
Oh,
you know.
Unbelievable writer.
Yeah.
Like, ridiculous. It's funny, when I was interviewing Pete Seeger, they wanted to take my film to Norman Lear. I actually wanted to ask you that as a favor after the
yeah.
show. I'm glad I... Thank you for mentioning
yeah.
that. You know, it's really interesting, too. I want to cut back, though. I'm going to cut you off. But your trailer that you cut
mm-hmm.
for your Sizzler,
mm-hmm.
that was phenomenal. And I mean, like, I don't know if you saw this trailer, but it had traditional entertainment value. It was cut like an entertainment sizzle, but with all that stuff in there.
For Soul Search?
Yeah,
you know
yeah, yeah,
about?
Yeah, yeah. Who was that person? I mean, how'd you do that?
Well, it began with the script. So Sister Jenna and I actually kind of wordsmithed the script. And said, what do we want to say?
Okay.
And then the brothers really have shot, they shot all those images. That's not stock imagery. They've gone around. They really have
wow.
a great eye. So they're very good with their cameras. And then once there was a story, as you know, what's the story? Then they were able to put those images with it.
I think they're going to show. We're going to go to break. They're going to show that trailer because I was so impressed.
Oh,
I really was. I was like, wow.
That's a good time.
It was unbelievable. I was like, wow, look at this. I was like, anyway, mm-hmm. this is, we're going to take a break on the green carpet with Stephen and Mark. Thank you so. We're cool.
No matter who you are, no matter where you go in life,
it carries us. leads, guides, and directs us. The Spirit. And if we could see ourselves, and if we could see each other the way we really are without filters, we would fall on our knees and literally love and worship each other. For the love, the beauty, the potential that is within us all. It is this view, this awakening, that will shift the very planet upon which we are living.
We have Keevan in the house, people.
That came across.
We like it.
Yeah. We like it. You know.
That's what I like to hear.
Yeah. We're proud of it. Shedding light to our
fears. When we listened back to the album a few times and when we were writing the songs, we were purposefully trying to do things that are different.
Song blew me away already, so
thank you, man. That's really cool that you called.
Hey guys, I'm Danny Boy.
And I'm Knocko Nolan.
See what I mean? Hey guys, I'm Danny Boy O'Connor.
And I'm Knocko Nolan.
And we're the
That's not written down.
All right, well, I'm gonna do it my way.
Okay.
No, it's okay, watch us as we uncover. And we're the Delta Bravo Urban Exploration Team. Join us every Friday from 7 to 9 p.m. Pacific Standard Time.
Or 10 to midnight for our East Coast friends.
Watch us as we uncover, discover, and explore music, movie, and true crime locations. The Delta Bravo Show every Friday, 7 p.m. right here on T Radio V. Radio and TV. Just put your hand
just like that.
Hi, I'm Greg Reitman. Always. I'm Greg Reitman. Watch my show On the Green Carpet every Tuesday at 2 p.m. right here on T Radio V. On the Green Carpet is a weekly show where art, music, fashion, entertainment come together to make a difference in the world. Each week, a celebrity will come on the show and they'll talk about what they're doing to make a difference. On the Green Carpet every Tuesday at 2 p.m. right here on T Radio V. Radio and TV.
Radio V. Radio in TV.
Radio in TV.
Here we are, back on the carpet, on the green carpet, with Stephen Powers and Mark Johnson. Sorry about that, Stephen. So we're going to come back. They're going to find that Vimeo link. But that was, tell me a little about what that other
video
was.
Well, that was a trailer for Michael Beckwith's film called Spiritual Liberation, which I made with Mickey Willis. Really, Mickey Willis made it, and he asked me to join him to be a contributor in terms of the music and co-producing of it. So that's a film. It's a day in the life of Michael Beckwith, and it uses the demonstration of the way he lives his life, walks his talk, to kind of be a way of teaching some of his spiritual principles.
Wow. So that's pretty amazing. And where did that film play?
Well, it was a DVD. It didn't go to theater. So it was a direct-to-DVD and has been shown a lot of places.
You got the video? Oh, wow. We can show the video?
Already.
So here. So
here's Soul Search.
So this is Soul Search. I'm telling you, I just love this trailer. Tell me about it. What was...
Well, the principle here, of course, is, again, we're showing a lot of the different spiritual and religious practices because that's where people start with, how do I learn something about myself? Religion. Is there another way? Is it beyond religion, trans-denominational? What kind
of... I love
of,
that shot, the trees. Yeah, I just say, really...
In nature, on a hike, in a run, a lot of ways to experience...
Big question.
Awareness, right? Wherever you are, in the subway.
And there you are, center stage.
Hello,
on town.
I'm Harry Sullivan Walden, and I am a dream expert.
I'm Stephen Powers. I'm a producer.
I'm Sister Jenna, and I run the Meditation Museum in the nation's capital.
Tell her I said hi, by the way. I gave her a blue marble.
And here's our fourth character, the RV.
Yeah, I saw that. That was very cool.
So here we are on the beach in Miami with the Mbanda in New York. It was a shamanism group. So they become possessed by entities, the Mbandas. They're whirling like Rumi, the Divas.
Oh, really? I didn't get that. Okay. It's funny. Everybody's seeking. You know what I mean? It's just where.
That's what it's all about. To me, this journey is about coming back home to the center. We just might explore the mysteries of what the soul really is.
Don't stash away.
Yeah.
All right.
If you're curious, come along with us.
And let's have a wonderful journey together. Why don't you just join us?
I love it. We just cut right out, right back out. I'm glad we got that back. I was like, that was saving grace. You know what I mean? So we were talking about money and commerce and coming back again to change, you know, the playing for change, you know. Is it a profit? Is it a foundation? You mentioned that you guys did $1 million in royalties.
Well, I mean, Playing for Change is a for-profit.
Okay.
We travel the world. We record and film musicians, make songs around the world. We distribute these albums and these videos. We also assembled some of the best musicians we met around the world, and we create the Playing for Change band. Last year, we toured in stadiums with Robert Plant. We're about to go on a 100-city tour all over the world this year. So those are for-profit businesses with merchandise, concert tickets, album sales, all the traditional stuff. Then we also have a separate Playing for Change Foundation where we build music and art schools around the world in a lot of the communities we've met throughout our travels. We have 9 music schools so far in 6 different countries. And, you know, so we have all these different things. We're constantly working to help make the world better. So sometimes it's in a for-profit context. Sometimes it's a non-profit context. But the royalties for our albums are given to the musicians that are featured in the videos. So they received well over $1 million in album sales. I mean, our first album, Through Starbucks and with Norman Lear, was a top 10 on Billboard. And it had all street musicians for the most part. There was a Zuni Indians were on it. But I mean, you know, this is a project for the people, man. And great music is everywhere. And that trumps commerce every time.
It's so interesting. When I went online, I was checking out Playing for Change, checking out the website. You got a lot of people. You got people in New York, San Francisco. I was going through, like, what are they doing? You got A&R people in every city or every country? What's going on?
Do you mean the musicians playing on the songs?
No. I don't think they were the musicians. They looked like they were like employees or different. You had their faces on.
Yeah, well, that's the team of people. Yeah, because there's managing a lot of the different things that are going on. So traveling to all the countries, and then there's the touring of the band, and then the running of the you know, it's an independent organization. We have a new partnership with Chris Blackwell. Founder of Island Records,
yeah.
And distribution with Starbucks. So there's a lot of different stuff going on.
So in terms of, like live concerts, are you working with like Live Nation, or where are we hearing these artists?
Yeah, well, we work with, our agency is Monterey International.
Okay.
So they do the touring for us, and Gorilla Management co-manage the band with Playing for Change. And, you know, so it's an amazing thing, though, to see these guys go like from the streets to the stage, and then they'd all fallen in love with each other from the videos. So this is how they'd met, is now in this touring band. So you see a lot of the musicians in the videos, then they come together on the stage.
I love it.
And
from the streets
connection,
to the stage.
Oh. Yeah, and that connection is so deep. And then also musically, you know, instead of world music, when I was growing up, it was always whatever wasn't American or British was world music. But now, I mean, world music should be the world playing music together.
Great
different
decoration.
Cultures, different experiences. You get something new that way. So we did a song I put out yesterday on Facebook, salsa, rumba, blues, Zulu, funk, all mixed into one song.
So take me back a little bit. So what's the relationship between Michael Johnson, Ava Mattson, and the International Day of Peace and Playing for Change?
Well, we have a thing called Playing for Change Day. Shares the same day.
So you share September 21st, the International Day of
Peace?
Yeah,
and last year we had 355 concerts on the same day in 56 countries, all for music education. And this year it's September 20th for our 4th annual. But it's a grassroots thing of people helping people. You know, that's what this is about.
That's really fabulous. So what's your takeaway? What do you think of, what do you think, doing good is possible?
It's a, it's a rhetorical question, Mark.
We both look puzzled.
Of course it is. Of course it is. You're living the dream, man, right? Yeah. From the streets to the stage. That's just fascinating.
Yeah. Well, that's such an incredible example of the answer to your question, that it clearly is possible. Yeah.
I mean, here's the thing. One of the guys in our band, his name is Grandpa Elliot, and he's famous from the Stand By Me video. But he'd been performing on the streets in New Orleans for 60 years, you know? And every day, he was the city's grandpa. So elderly people, young people, white, black, everybody, he was their person. And now he travels the world and they treat him like Elvis when he walks on the stage. And those standing ovations, I mean, that to me is the change that you can see in the world. I mean, here's this guy who's been giving his whole life and now he gets to feel this connection and he gets to see it travel the world. So change is definitely more than possible. It's very real.
So you're going
can
on.
Can I add to that?
Yeah, please.
Just from my own personal experience, because I love that very inspiring story. John Lee Hooker, which is one of the great relationships in my life, and the album The Healer that I had the honor of being a part of. John Lee was 73 years old when that album was recorded, and he became, from kind of an obscure bluesman to a worldwide phenomenon, sold 3 million albums and won a Grammy at the age of 73. So it's kind of a Grandpa Elliot story of somebody coming into their greatest work, you know, at later in life, at a time when somebody might say, you know, it's no longer possible for me. And so possibility, that's just a demonstration of the enormous breadth of it.
You have totally inspired me. When I think of the concept of from the street to the stage, of every musician that's out there, what you have done is you've given a voice. You've given a vehicle of self-expression, and it's really brilliant. And I'm just jazzed right now. Mm-hmm. I mean, when I think about both of you. No. But just both of you guys, of what you're doing and just, like, the idea of a moment. Like, you had a moment. Like, you went to Agape, and all of a sudden, you spent 7 years, you know, at Agape. And I just want to say, guys, our show is pretty much, we're about to, like, conclude. We're done. Can you believe it? It's been an hour.
But for everybody, there's a life full of moments. So just be aware and seize them. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Greg, thank you for this moment.
Yeah, thank you, Greg, Mark absolutely. Johnson. Thank you, Stephen Powers. We're here on the green carpet at T Radio V. Peace.
You are watching T Radio V. Radio in TV.